The next there is a wonderful speaker who is Dr. Navin Jairamji. So he holds a MBBS degree and MD in psychiatry. He has been awarded a gold medal in ophthalmology by the Academic Committee SDUMC, Best Resident Award from the Department of Psychiatry for the year 2009-12, a Young Scientists Award by World Federation of Societies for Biological Psychiatry by CES Republic in 2011, CDE grant from European Congress and Psychopharmacology in 2017. He is the lifetime member of Indian Psychiatric Society and World Association of Psychosocial Rehabilitation. Currently, he is working as a consultant psychiatrist in SAKRA, World Hospital, and Guru Shri Healthcare, Whitefield, Bangalore. So this is a short introduction about Dr. Navin Jairamji. So I hand over the session to Navin Jairamji. So please, over to Navin sir.
Namaste. Namaste everyone. Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Happy Independence Day to all of you. I'm really delighted to be a part of this panelist on this Independence Day, and we are also discussing about the mind independence. I thank Rotary Bangalore Global Yoga. I thank all the Rotarians. I thank Spiritual Solutions Center and Vishwanath Guruji for giving me this opportunity to discuss my perspective about yoga or mano yoga, and also to share some of the research which I was also part of as a part of my research into the yoga. Guruji, I think, mentioned about how we understand our mind from the perspective of our ancient yogic sciences. I am coming from a scientific community. I can say that most of the things I knew before I reached out to Guruji, or I just connected with our ancient spiritual sciences, was to do only with a modern scientific approach, where I think I'll be talking about it in detail, that we have limited understanding. So many question marks during our journey, many things are unanswered, and you know, we were still waiting for the technology to take over and give us some information. Probably, you know, I have told many people that probably in the next 20-30 years we will be able to understand mind better. But you know, the happiest thing was that I think all these things are already described by our rishis and yogis. I want to start my presentation with a simple quote, that the only true wisdom is knowing you know nothing. So this is how I started probably my journey, that we didn't know anything. Coming to the contents of my presentation, I will give you a little bit understanding about what psychology or modern science thinks about mind, how mind works, how, as Guruji mentioned, how these emotions, memories are conditioned inside our brain. Also, considering the modern pandemic and the stress we are all experiencing nowadays, I will give you some understanding about how stress affects on our mind, and also free tips about how we can make our mind to be in a wellness state. And also I would like to talk about what happens to our mind, what have we understood in terms of scientific research, what happens to mind, and what chemicals or what changes happens in the mind that I'll be discussing. So to start with, I think, as I mentioned, yogic sciences, our ancient sciences, have a comprehensive and complete understanding about everything. You know, mind is infinite, mind is everywhere, most of the learnings in the ancient science happened, there are written scripts, but I think most of the learning happened through experiences. So the Guru Shishya Parampara, or teaching and learning from one person to another person. So that's how the knowledge or wisdom was shared in the previous era. So even though we have a comprehensive list, we might also know that, I think, you know, it is too extensive for our minds to assimilate that information and bring it into practice. Also, our science talks about healing potential of the body, healing potential of the mind, healing potential of the body. We always wonder, right, how our body is controlled by itself. 90% of our body functions is automatic. Who programmed this body to do all the things automatically? Conscious control over our body is very, very limited. So all these healing potentials are already programmed inside us. Also, as Guruji mentioned, I think samskaras and karmas are able to describe each person's attitudes, each person's beliefs about the whole yoga system, about understanding of ancient system, how we can make our life into a fulfilling one or a better one. Also, the concepts about wellness to a, from particular age to the illness. I think there is a description about wellness to illness concept, which is very extensive. Also, as we will continue to know about energy systems, the meridians in the body, the prana koshas, and also, I think, a clear mention of how we are connected with the universal energy or the divine energy, and how that is very much essential for us to function on a day-to-day basis. Let me come to modern understanding. I think right now, you can take any kind of wellness or illness. The mainstay of treatment remains technology and drugs. I think this is what we all understand, that this is the mainstay, is what the Western world or the modern science considers. There might be various reasons for that. Yogic sciences are classified under a group called complementary and alternative medicine. Complementary and alternative medicines are classified where if the, you know, drug therapy or other therapies fail, and that is when we are going to introduce these concepts. So this is the understanding of the modern science. Most of the learning here happens through information. So we get a lot of information about mind, we get a lot of information about neurons, we know about a lot of neurochemicals, and you know, there is a more of an informative learning than the experiential learning. There are people who can speak about yoga, they talk about mind, but have we really experienced what it feels like? So that is what was happening to me also when I was doing research on yoga, but I was not understanding the root basis. Also, many a times we tell that mind is a complex structure and we have very limited understanding about how mind works. To put little more insight on this, I think with the research, people have identified now that people who are meditating for a long time have a potential to use most of the neurons. That means they can use that 70, 80 or 90% of the brain compared to the person who's not into those kind of practices. So what constitute minds? It's again infinite, very difficult to narrow down. We can show our brain that mind is inside the brain, but very difficult to tease out and identify. Probably mind can be called in simplistic terms as a software which runs our body and soul. So it is a software which has connection with the soul and connection with the body, and it is probably an intermediary thing which takes care of mind and soul. So another understanding of science is it's a bunch of neurons. So mind is probably a bunch of neurons. We have an adult brain contains 100 billion neurons. So it's a bunch of neurons which are transmitting information from one group to another group. There is a continuous flow of energy in the form of chemical transmission, and you know, that flow is what keeps our thoughts, our actions, our impressions in the mind. Let us understand a brief view about conscious mind and subconscious mind. As Guruji mentioned, Jagrat probably is considered as a conscious mind. This is what we have control over. We have control over conscious mind to some extent. We logicalize, we tell what is right or wrong based on our understanding of this. The most important part was subconscious mind. So some psychological theories will understand mind as conscious and subconscious and unconscious mind, but certain theories work only with the principle of conscious mind. For example, there is a therapy called as behavioral therapy or cognitive behavioral therapy. These therapies apply our jagrut or conscious mind to improve our thinking, our emotions and our behavior. Whereas the application of meditation, hypnotherapy, pratiprasava, all these sadhanas will happen only with an understanding of our subconscious. This is where the beliefs, the emotions, the habits have stored in the mind. I will also discuss how this storage happens. The most important part here is the imagination and intuition. Subconscious power runs our day-to-day basis. So this is the mapping of the brain regions. The reason I want to talk about this is our brain is very powerful. For example, now I'm speaking to you and all of you are listening to me, actively listening to me. But at the same time, when you're listening to me, there'll be some background thoughts also going on in your mind. You might be thinking about the topic I'm talking, you might be thinking about what needs to be done next. So that is the inner voice which is running in your mind. From the evolutionary perspective, we had a larger brain, animalistic brain in the beginning. And as we became human beings or Homo sapiens, the size of the brain started shrinking. So in order to maintain all the functions, the brain became very concised. So that means to say many regions of the brain will do multiple tasks. It's not one region doing one task. There is an amazing coordination between each and every part of the brain. For example, now you are listening to me, you're trying to understand what the concept is, you're assimilating that information, and if I ask a question, immediately you'll be able to respond. So that means to say all these functions are happening at the same time. Within, when we are having a communication, so many regions in the brain will light up in order to undergo this experience. Coming to memory and conditioning, what Guruji was mentioning, every thought process with an emotional feeling will be stored in the belief system. That means it is stored in a neural pathway. This is what we call it as a neural pathway. Let us say some very scary event happens in childhood. It might not be only in childhood, it might be from past lives as well. That event was so significant that memory, it is stored in the body in the form of a neural pathway. So that feeling got stored, and with repetitive experience of similar kind of fear, this neural pathway will become stronger. So many people, I think, experience phobias. They have gone to a place for the first time, they never had feelings of phobia, and suddenly they experience feelings of phobia. Where is it coming from? Is the neural pathway from the past, in this current life, childhood life, or also it might be dating back to a very past experience. So most of these things are stored in the form of belief systems. This is what defines our attitudes, how we interact with ourselves, how we interact with people, how we interact with environment. So there might be numerous belief systems in each and every person. So the neural pathways and neural networking is different for each person. So imagine, so we have a vast diversity of neural patterns. That is another reason why the complexity of mind is not very easy to understand for the scientific community. So I was mentioning about how the information passes through the neurons. So the information from the neurons passes through the neural pathways, that is a nerve terminal in the form of chemicals. These are all the chemicals many of us might know about, dopamine, about adrenaline, about GABA. These are all are being identified by our scientific community. And these are all the things which will get affected when we are practicing yogasana, practicing pranayama and other mind relaxing techniques. So these are very much essential. When we are having a conversation, certain pathways, certain neurotransmitters will get released. We have identified those regions because of the modern technology. So most important ones in this being dopamine, adrenaline, serotonin and endorphins. For the memory part, acetylcholine and glutamine is very, very important. So there is a constant influx. And this is the basis for most of the treatment of mental disorders. We have a limited understanding again, but this is the basis where there is a deficiency of chemicals. We have to give chemicals to solve the issue. That's how the scientific community looks into it. Having spoken about the neural pathways and how the impressions form in the mind, let us go to understand the effects of stress on the mind. So when we talk about stress, I think there is a concept of positive and negative stress. We need an optimum level of stress. That means when I mention stress, there is an optimum level of adrenaline. It's very much necessary for us to function in a calm way. For example, I have good energy, good memory, good concentration. I am relaxed. I'm taking things very easily. I'm able to handle my day-to-day practice. For that, an optimum amount is necessary. Too low stress, probably I would not be able to handle my day-to-day basis in a significant way. Too high stress will lead to breakdown, and that will lead to too much of problems. What do you mean by stress? Excessive thoughts, excessive thinking, excessive feeling where your conscious mind is not able to regulate might be the reason. Emotional things stored up might be the reason for stress. So there is a response system which is already programmed in the body. Whenever there is stress, there is a system in the body which gets activated, which releases some chemicals like adrenaline, and that is how it takes care of that acute stress. So if something happens immediately, suddenly we feel unpleasant sensations in the body, that is the way stress hormones will get released inside. They affect all the system, they affect our inflammation, they affect our heart rate, they affect our body's functioning. And once the stress goes off, they all come back to normal state of harmony. But in case this stressful situation remains for a long time, then body will not be able to come back to harmony, and that is where the damage of the body cells happens. Each and every cell, since we are connected from head to toe, we are connected from mind and body, anything can get affected. So mainly in the brain, what happens in the brain? This is a sample taken from hippocampal region of an animal model study. So what happens when this animal is experiencing continuous stress? You can also notice that the B diagram is showing that there are loss of neurons. There are death of neurons where the branching and connections in the mind is getting affected. So dear friends, when we are experiencing constant stress and constant emotional feelings, this is what happens to our minds also. And this is the reason why we will not be able to function to the optimum level when these experiences are going on. Also, we have a very good understanding that these are the emotions or the stress cycles which can also get stored in the organs. So this is the main basis for developing most of the psychosomatic conditions and also chronic conditions in the body. Scientific community completely accepts it that emotions can get stored in any part of the body. Another important underpinning which connects our mind and body is the autonomic nervous system. I would say we can, if we understand Ida Pingala and Sushumna Nadis, we can also understand the autonomic nervous system in a significantly better fashion. There is sympathetic, which I normally call as accelerator. Sympathetic is always on the run, and parasympathetic we call it as brakes. This is always there to relax us. So this system explains most of the psychosomatic conditions. There are people getting chest pain, but there's no reason found, and they are experiencing it purely because of their emotional states. This can happen with any kind of condition. So in modern science, if they cannot find a reason, the response will be that you are creating it. So this is where there is a little bit of wrong understanding that nobody creates the problems by themselves, and we cannot create those problems. There will be a basis and underpinnings from the past, our behaviors, our environmental interaction, and the cellular memory, what we have stored in the past, can get activated at any point of time. So what we need to practice in order to be mentally healthy, what mind yoga practices on a regular basis, is very important. In the modern times, probably I assume that we are behind quick remedies. So the solution focused remedies, we need to become better a little faster. So we have quick techniques nowadays, probably even in yoga. But I think the most important principle of Patanjali, I want to take it here, that Yama Niyama is the most important principle we need to follow before we start any kind of practice. Probably a brief knowledge and information about the practices, how it works on my mind and body is also very important. And experiences. So a learning practices, learning from a master, learning from a guru, might be a better learning compared to what we can learn watching a video or what we can learn by information. Definitely informative learning is good, but I completely propose that experiential learning is always a very golden moment for us. So the practice of relaxation, breathing techniques of pranayamas, which my colleague will speak in a little more detail, meditation and how to explore the mind power, the effect of positive affirmations on the mind and body. Dear friends, as I mentioned that when you are listening, there is an inner voice talking inside you. Research also understands about that inner voice. That is the inner voice which is connected with our samskaras, our intuition and our karmas. So most of the time it is found that we are communicating inadequacies, we are communicating insecure feelings, we are communicating what we don't have, or we are communicating what we lack. So this is how the communication happens. We have a lot of things around us, but that presence or the mindful presence in the moment is very much necessary to explore and understand what is there around us. Also, sometimes self-healing might not be completely possible. So there are certain conditions which are very deep rooted, where meditative practices and relaxation practices probably will not be able to reach to the root. So this is where the hetero healing or spiritual healing and therapies, hypnotherapy, past life regression therapy comes into play. So this is where you need a support of the therapist to guide you. Even in the healing practice, you are the person who is going to heal. And the only guidance of a therapist is to guide you through the process. So the guide, healing happens, Guruji's golden word is that healing happens irrespective of the healer. Healing is always there. We just need to connect proper cards there from the past so that healing starts and it finishes by itself. Just stopping at wellness probably is not enough. As Guruji mentioned, I think our aim should be to make our life really enriching and fulfilling. Our quest to understand mind and mind power should continue our journey, because this is necessary for us to give information to other people. You have experienced certain states, and it is better for you to talk about those experiences to other people, and people will also be able to understand. I also have a little negative loop about people who use drugs to reach this state. So I keep coming across many people who want to quickly go to this blissful, tranquil states with the use of drugs and other things. But probably that is not the right way. We have all the resources inside us. Just need to plug in and continue to practice these things. But we need to experience blissful states and healing states very often. So what happens to mind and body? So what are the chemical changes we have identified? I'll also show some research studies which we have, which I was also part of. But with the practice of Mano Yoga, with the practice of relaxation exercises, asanas, pranayamas, hypnotherapy, and these practices, there'll be a lot of changes happening in the brain. This has been identified. I can also show some evidences. Oxytocin is one of the hormone for social bonding. So oxytocin is improving when we are practicing these things in the brain. The release of oxytocin improves. I showed some connections and neuronal attachments and pathways. Neurotransmitters and signaling will become more sharper. It becomes relaxed and it becomes sharper. So your concentration and memory will become very, very easy when you are practicing these things. The ability of the mind to understand and focus on things will improve with this. Also, the studies show that the stress hormone, cortisol is called as a stress hormone, which is known to damage our mind and body. So it decreases cortisol level with the practices. Also, there are studies talking about improving endorphins and BDNF. BDNF is a brain-derived neurotrophic factor. This is an essential factor for the neurons to develop connections. Anything we learn new, there will be a connection. And that connection, if you repeat the same thing, will be stored as a long-term memory. For that, BDNF is very much necessary. And when we go through the states of mental illnesses or mental disorders, we will have deficiency of BDNF, endorphins, and serotonin and dopamine in the brain. Also, as I showed, the brain-heart synchrony will improve the connection. The sympathetic and parasympathetic system will go into a very good balance, and high parasympathetic tone. I think for a vehicle, if you have very good brakes, it is always better, because we don't know, you know, how much speed we go and what might happen in the future. Uncertainty definitely remains, but we need to have good brakes for our vehicle. That is very much necessary. Also, a lot of evidence is that endocrine system, the most important hormonal system, will get balanced. Dear friends, I want to bring this important concept here, that the change doesn't remain only with some nerve cells. It happens at the level of DNA. Each and every cell contains DNA. DNA is the active component of our existence, we can say. So researchers are able to go to an extent that they can identify changes in the genes with the change in emotions and change in practices. Probably we'll be able to know better when Guruma speaks about these experiments. So the last part of my presentation, I want to talk about some of our studies which we did in MHANS, Advanced Center for Yoga, about certain conditions. So here I'm really speaking about mental disorders. Many of you might not be aware about what mental disorder is. For example, if I talk about schizophrenia, you will not have any idea. I'll just give brief idea about schizophrenia. Schizophrenia in Kannada is called as chitta vikalate. So where there will be a lot of disturbances in the mind. As Guruji mentioned, the energy systems go haywire. They will have connections with many other energy sources. So they might have hallucinations, they might have delusional thinking, somebody is trying to harm, they might have a significant paranoid ideations about everything happening. Also, you know, they will, when they are having this disorder, they fail to recognize other people's emotions also. It's not like they cannot feel their emotions, they fail to recognize other people's emotions also. So this is about schizophrenia, and when it becomes severe, probably certain people will not be able to do anything. They will become, they will not be able to communicate, not be able to work, and not be able to take up any kind of job and activities. So there was a study which was published in 2012. This was done for patients who are little better with schizophrenia, who are able to practice yoga, asanas, and exercise. There was a comparison done between yoga, exercise, and a weightless group. And the study significantly showed that the symptoms of the condition, the symptoms of the disease, definitely improved with the practice of asanas. So certain asanas and pranayama techniques were devised during this study, and that is what was seen. So we noticed also significant improvement in social functioning of these people. So another study where people who are acutely sick, you know, when they have active diseases also. So it depends. See, some people might not be able to follow the instructions, but when they have active disease and they're able to follow the instructions during the assessment points, we also notice that severity comes down with similar kind of yoga practices in patients with schizophrenia. This is another important change in terms of their functioning, you know, in schizophrenia. Again, the improvement, you can notice that yoga had better improvement compared to the weightless and exercise group. So this is the study which I undertook personally. So here what we studied was to understand what happens to patients with schizophrenia when they have to recognize people's faces. We call it as facial emotion recognition problems. So we have a software tool to identify those things, and they were put into a, you practice. The sample size is very less due to various reasons, but after the practice for a month or so, we normally tell it takes 2 to 3 months for the neurochemicals to change. But surprisingly, what we noticed was that oxytocin levels in the plasma of the patients who were exposed to yogic practices was noted to be significantly higher compared to the waitlist group. So the comparison should always happen for the waitlist or a placebo group. So we noticed significant improvement in oxytocin levels when we did this study. I have presented the results in various conferences, and this study has been quoted by many community to understand, or when they are writing about the chemical changes happening with yoga practice. Also, we made some hypothesis about what happens to brain of a person with schizophrenia. Probably this is a good understanding that even with dhyana and meditation or postures, you know, there will be a focused attention in their mind in certain regions. Even though there are a lot of disharmony in the mind, with this focused attention and open monitoring, there will be a significant strengthening of network of neurons in the mind. And this network, again, with the combined with the release of oxytocin, and also there is a concept of mirror neuron system. What is mirror neuron system? This is one important scientific understanding about the mind power. When we are watching somebody experiencing something, some emotion, the same feelings will come to us. For example, if you are looking at somebody smiling, so when you smile, something happens in the mind. When we are not smiling ourselves, we are looking at somebody smiling, the similar kind of neurons or similar kind of mechanism will get activated inside us. So this is because of the wonderful mirror neurons we carry in our mind. This is very important for a part of communication and theory of mind concepts. This mirror neuron system, we talk about schizophrenia, we talk about kids who have autism, ADHD, and these kind of, you know, socially communicating kind of, there's a vast research available on this. So this definitely has given us good results. We are a long way to go, but with minor changes, improvement in social cognition, social connectedness, and also the functioning of the people will definitely improve. Next few slides, I'll be talking about the most common problem the world or globally we are facing right now. I think 280 million people in the world are suffering from this condition, which is called as depression, or we call it as Khinnathe in Kannada. So these are studies were done initial part when Sudarshan Kriya Yoga was initiated in Bangalore. And with the practice here, actually one good thing was it was compared with medication also, which is used for antidepressant medication and other treatments like electrical stimulation was compared with Sudarshan Kriya Yoga. We got wonderful results with Kriya Yoga compared to the other. So this is one of the very well quoted research studies in the practice of depression. So there was improvement with a combination of yoga only, and also drug with yoga also gave a good results compared to the drug. So natural practices still have a good validity in improving depression. As I was previously mentioning about brain-derived neurotrophic factor, this is the study where brain-derived neurotrophic factor levels was measured in the plasma, and we noticed significant improvement post practice of yoga. And this is again another thing where therapy treatment of depression with yoga improves the brain-derived neurotrophic factor. This is another important study. Probably it is too difficult to understand, but you need to be looking at the chart A and other B, C, E, and F. So A is a control person, so where the person is not doing anything. This was done to see what happens to the brain when we are doing Om chanting. So when we sit, this is the person who is there, put in fMRI and asked to chant Om. The yellow spots, what you are noticing in the scans, indicates deactivation of that region. So these are the regions of limbic system. So limbic system is the seat of emotions. So this is where our emotional feelings and emotional networks are created. What you can see is that this It produces deactivation of limbic system. What does that say? That Om chanting has the power to deactivate your emotional state in that moment when you are practicing it. So that means it completely relaxes you from the emotional overtones, what you are experiencing at that moment. And this, again, we have proposed that when we are chanting Om, our ears are listening it. There's a nerve called as vagal nerve. Vagal nerve is the one which is a main nerve for the parasympathetic nervous system. Probably again, the concept of Ida and Pingala comes here. So this nerve, vagal nerve stimulation, has been known as a mechanism to cause this particular effect on the mind. There is a lot of research still happening on this particular thing, but this is an initial response which is published in an international journal. Coming to other aspects, so we spoke about depression. Now, there are research studies done in elderly who have memory issues, who have issues in terms of mood and concentration. Because as we age, our neurons, we believe that neurons are going to become weak or they're going to die. But there are a lot of research to talk about improvement in memory and concentration when people were elderly. Also, there have been improvement in quality of life. Quality of life is where you ask people how you are feeling about yourself, how you are feeling about the world around you, the family. And people who practiced yoga felt that their quality of life was much better compared to people who did not. Also, the quality of sleep. Most of the people, as we age, I think our sleep cycle will get impaired because of the aging. And I think the duration of sleep also comes down, the quality of sleep also comes down. So this parameter was also measured and found that you definitely the quality of sleep will improve with the practices of yoga. This is another activation noticed with people who are having memory issues. So again, we noticed significant changes in the elderly people when the practice was done. Yes. So what are the problems we are facing to do research? These are, I think there are vast, numerous articles published from our country and in the Western society, ranging from cancer to irritable bowel syndrome to pain symptoms and many, many conditions. There are a lot of research has happened. But, you know, the problems we are facing in our country in terms of research is about whether we should call it as a lifestyle or we should propose it as a mainstream of therapy. That is where the questions are coming from. Also, standardization is very much necessary. If you want to publish or you want to make a good study, the standardizing procedures are very, very important. Also, scientific community nowadays accepts RCTs. These are called as randomized control trials. What is randomized control trial? You have to prove, for example, I'm proving two drugs. One drug is better than placebo. So placebo and drug has to, people who take placebo, which is a dummy drug, and people who take the real drug. So that comparison should happen. And the persons don't know what they're taking. So this kind of blinding and all is practically not possible because, you know, we also understand that the feeling that I'm doing something itself can improve our mind and neurochemicals, the feeling that I'm doing something. So we cannot, you know, make that bias during. So double blinding is definitely not possible in certain studies of yoga. Also, for the scientific community, we tell that in our country, it is culturally most acceptable. Many people during these studies were very open to participate in the study and practice, take the practices. Also, I think it improves their quality, that the level of drugs what they're taking can be reduced or stopped based on that thing. Most of the people will feel that accomplishment after the practice of yoga, that I'm able to come out of my condition natural way with my own practices and own belief systems. So now I think the institution where I work and in touch with are developing specific. I'm finishing in one last one slide. Last one. So these are the conditions where we are developing genetic modules for improving in yoga. To recapitulate, I think our wisdom of yogic sciences is vast. I feel that scientific community should take these instances and start working through it. Probably with this background and platform, we'll be able to reach to understand mind in a better fashion and also the underpinnings. So we are, I think modern science is still catching up with our wisdom. So at this moment, yes. And we also understood briefly about the stress response system and how hormonal release will affect us. So also, friends, we understood the concept of how to be, you know, well, and, you know, talked about fulfillment, optimum functioning, and life purpose. Certain neurobiological underpinnings I spoke, and also the evidence-based treatment. I think in the next speakers will talk about science of pranayama and mind miracles. Kuruma will be talking about that. Finally, acknowledgements to Vishwanath Guruji, Kuruma Gayatri, and Spiritual Solutions Center, my gurus in EMHANS, Professor Gangadhar, Professor Shivram Marambali. And I also thank Rotary Bangalore Global Yoga and all the Rotarians who are behind organizing this program. Thank you, everyone. Namaste.